Welcome to this tutorial to Room EQ Wizard, a really powerful freeware software that makes it possible to analyze your room acoustics and what's happening to your loudspeakers. The software can be downloaded at roomwizard.com. You can find several installers for Windows, for Mac and even Linux, some of them also containing the Java package. There's also an overview for the equipment you'll need, for example, a USB microphone, or the famous Dayton, a really inexpensive microphone, and some suggestions for interfaces. In the end, you can use every interface or even simply your built-in sound card. If you want to use a condenser measuring mic, make sure that your interface provides phantom power. And for the deeper insight, of course, there are really good books also listed here. To use Room EQ Wizard, you need the following. Of course, a computer. I think that's quite obvious. An audio interface. Here I'm using a Babyface. So here you can see we are using a line in for the measuring microphone and a line out to provide the measuring signal generated by REW, which is sent to the speaker. And as said before, of course, you can use internal sound cards as well. If you want to calibrate your interface, you simply connect the line out and the line in. In the case of the Babyface, you can see this is quite easy. This is the measuring microphone I'm using here. This is an Earthworks, a little expensive. I'm glad that our company has one because we are measuring PA systems. This measuring microphone should point towards the speaker. There are also microphones that simply point upwards. Just check out the manual. Yes, so let's go and start the software. We first open the preferences to make sure that everything is configured the right way. We'll select the driver of the interface. In that case, it's an ASIO driver. If you're using an internal solution, you can also select it here. We select the output that will provide the sweep from Room EQ Wizard to the speaker. So this output is connected with your speaker. And here we select the input for the measuring microphone. In that case, it's input 2. This is the input the measuring microphone is connected to. Once again, if you're using a measuring microphone with a condenser capsule, make sure that phantom power is turned on. Otherwise, there's silence. If you'd like to calibrate your interface, you can connect this output with this input and then simply use the calibrate function. Usually this is not needed, as even really inexpensive interfaces are built on a really high level. And now we can start the measuring. You can ignore the message that's now popping up saying that SPL is not calibrated. That's correct. If you'd like to do this, you would need a special SPL meter. But this is just important if you're using absolute SPL levels, so it's not important for us. We select ignore it. You can now configure the sweep that it's used to measure the speaker. So the sweep is played back through the speaker and the microphone is recording it. I've chosen -6 dB full scale, and one sweep is fine as well. Output, once again, as configured in the preferences, it's output 2, and we're using input 2 for the microphone. Now it's about levels. So first we should make sure that we reduce the level of our playback system, just to make sure that the first sweep is not that loud. As you can see, the measuring signal reached the -6 dB, but it was -50 on the microphone. This is not that much. So I'll increase the playback level. So, and now the signal reached the -30 dBs, and Room EQ Wizard is telling us this is okay. So we are okay with that. So now we click Start Measuring. The microphone now has to be at ear level at the listening position. And as I said before, some microphones should point towards the speaker and others should simply point towards your ceiling. Just read the manual. And let's go. Yeah, that's it. Here's your result. And take a look at this diagram. I think it's not that obvious. This one's showing SPL and phase. First of all, as we want to focus on the frequency response, we choose all SPL. That's how it looks. We have the option to use smoothing in different levels. For example, here are too many details. That's the 48 smoothing. You can use that. And I think I would suggest we use a 12 smoothing. And now it's quite obvious that this loudspeaker in the real room is no longer linear, especially in the bass range. If we now would like to focus on the range that's really interesting for us, we can change the limits. So I would like to focus on the bass range and the lower mids. So first of all, I'll take a look at how low this speaker can play back. So in that case, it's approximately 40 Hertz. So I'll enter 40 Hertz and let's go for 800. And this range, of course, is just to adjust what is displayed. And if I'd like to focus on a certain range, it really makes sense to use this adjustment. Yes, and in my opinion, it's a good range to go for 800 Hertz as the upper limit. What I'm doing now, you can see this line, which is somehow my reference level. And I'm now trying to adjust this, that, you know, it's somehow in the middle of everything. Perhaps it makes sense now to show you the complete frequency range. And now I'm trying to adjust this line somehow as a middle axis of all the frequencies. You don't have to be that precise. Now I'm getting back to the old limits, 40 Hertz and 800. Yeah, now we know what's happening in our room. And somehow this is bad for us. Because, for example, this boost, which is a really high boost, can of course influence the way you are mixing or the way you are listening to music. Room EQ Wizard is also offering a second option I would like to show to you now that makes it possible to analyze how reverberant your room is. It's called waterfall diagram. In the beginning it's empty, we'll change that by selecting generate. Yeah, now you can see these modal frequencies, which are somehow ringing or resonating for a longer time in your room. These are these large slices. To explain this in short, this shows somehow the decay of the frequency. So how long does it take for a frequency to stop ringing in your room? And higher frequencies have a shorter decay than the bass frequencies. Here it's also possible to adjust the values. So I first select controls. At the moment, I'm using a time range of 300 milliseconds, which is somehow useful for studios. I now will select 1 second, 1000 milliseconds. So you see at least none of these frequencies is ringing for 1 second in my room because nothing of this is reaching our front layer. But of course, I'm aiming, for example, for 300 milliseconds. And then I have to admit, in this time range, it's resonating longer. And if you want to get rid of this, it's no option to use EQs or to measure your speakers. In that case, you will have to go for absorbers or bass traps. In my room, I'm using some, you know, simple absorbers and they work fine in that area. But for the bass area, I would need bass traps. Yeah, that's the waterfall diagram. Perfect tool to see what's happening on the time axis. So what can we do now to somehow compensate the room influences when we are listening to our speakers? So now we'll select, after closing controls, EQ. And what we'd like to do now is reducing the boosts that are caused by the modal frequencies. And this is a very important information. If there are notches, they are always caused by reflections and cancellations. One example, if you place a speaker 1 meter away from the back wall, you will have a dip at 90 Hz. This is because direct sound travels to you, starting from the membrane, and in the bass area, the speakers are always omnidirectional, sound gets reflected, and so these two waves are causing a cancellation at your listening position. If you know the distance, you can calculate where the dip will be. And once again, it's not possible to avoid this cancellation by boosting this frequency range. Because if you're boosting, of course, you're getting more direct sound in this frequency range. But there's also more of this frequency range that gets reflected by your back wall. So it doesn't make any sense. EQ section. We simply select generic. If you are using, for example, Mini DSP, of course, you can select this one. We now go for manual adjustments. It's generic. Target setting, we don't use a subwoofer. We are using a full range speaker. And here we can adjust a target curve. And we now want to optimize for a linear frequency response. So I don't want to use any rise or fall slopes. I'll select zero. And the target level should be similar to what we have adjusted before. In our case, it's 57. Yeah, now you can see the axis is now at 57. And as I said before, once again, really important, no boosts. So if there's any number that is not zero, you have to go for zero. We are looking at the range starting from 20 Hz to 800 Hz. And we'd like to use a window of 3 dBs, which is quite okay. And now we'll let Room EQ Wizard calculate filters. So we click on Match Response to Target. So, and now you can see what's happening. It calculates filters that invert everything that is boosted by the modal frequencies. If you would like to do this manually, you can use this invert filters, then you can somehow fill what you are seeing. Yeah, and that's a really easy way to get the filter settings to compensate what's happening in our room at our listening position. The filter listing now shows, for example, 126 Hz, it's 18 dBs too much, a boost of 12 dBs at 62 Hz, 5.5 at 400 Hz, and so on. And you can use this filter listing now, for example, using an EQ in your master section of your DAW and compensate the influences of your room. You can export these filter settings as a text file, and this text file then shows you the frequency, gain, and the Q value. Yeah, and just be aware of that different EQs, for example, have different slopes, or the Q values are handled differently. And because I'm working with Genelec all the time, I can tell you they are offering SAM, which means Smart Active Monitors. These are loudspeakers and subwoofers with built-in internal DSPs. And these are adjusted using a measuring system with a microphone, which is part of their so-called GLM, Genelec Loudspeaker Manager. And so things are getting even easier because you don't need any external equipment or filtering. Everything is in the speaker, and you can use them standalone. But of course, Room EQ Wizard is an excellent option for all of you, for example, working on an analog basis with normal speakers somehow, simply to know what's going on in your room and to realize that the influences of the room really change the way you are mixing, producing, or the way you are listening to music. If you'd like to compare measurings, for example, before you have been installing absorbers and after you installed them, you can do so. Just let me open a file that includes two measurings. Yeah, now you see this is an overlay of multiple measurings, and I can turn them on and off, and then you can easily compare. For example, here you can see this curve is showing the frequency response adjusted with Genelex GLM, and the other one is without any adjustments. If you'd like to use different colors, you can easily do this simply by selecting a color. And now it gets a little easier to see the different measurings. And you can draw your conclusions. So what's happening? Finally, what's also important, always measure each speaker individually. If you are having a stereo system, look for a good compromise of the filters or adjust them separately. But each speaker gets its own sweep. It doesn't make any sense to play back the sweep on multiple speakers at the same time, simply because there would be too many interactions and you won't be able to draw your conclusions. Same for multiple subwoofers. Each subwoofer gets measured. Each subwoofer gets its own filter curve. And then each subwoofer somehow couples perfectly to the room. If you are having a surround setup or immersive sound with ceiling loudspeakers, it's the same. Each speaker is measured individually. And make sure that the time of flight is correct. For surround, the ideal positioning is a circle, so if a speaker is too close, you have to delay it and the level has to be lower. For immersive, it's the ideal of a globe. And if all this is taken into account, it simply sounds way better. Thanks for your attention.